Okay, so thanks to the organisers for a great workshop so far. And today I'm going to be talking about the effects of quantum coherence in electron transfer in respiratory complex 1. The paper's here, and this is done in collaboration with Ross Dorner from Imperial, John Gould, Tristan and Vlatko from Oxford and CQT at the National University in Singapore. We've also been discussing quite heavily with two mitochondrial biologists from Cambridge, Philippa Roberts and Judy Hurst. Okay. So this work was inspired actually by a conference that was organized by Paul Davies at the University of Arizona back in 2010. The title of the conference was Quantum Effects in Cancer. So, of course, when you get invited to speak at a conference, a workshop like this, you wonder what you're going to speak about. So what we decided, Vlatko and I, was to look for a system that could support quantum effects in eukaryotic cells. So something perhaps like energy transport in photosynthesis. But also we wanted a system that was involved with development of cancer. Of course, we wouldn't be able to say anything about whether the quantum effects played a role in cancer, but at least we could say perhaps there could be some quantum effects that eventually, I don't know, anyway. So we spoke to some cancer researchers at the University of Oxford, and they pointed us in the direction of the mitochondria, and they said, hey, there's electron transfer in the mitochondria, why don't you look there? So after some research, like digging through the literature and so on, we came up with the respiratory complex 1, which I'll tell you about in more detail shortly. And the nice thing here, the thing with this enzyme is that defects in it can lead to an increase of metastasis of cancer and so on. So also, defects in complex 1 are related to Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, diabetes, and aging. So it's really important to understand the functioning of this enzyme, whether it has any quantum mechanics or not. Okay, so electron transfer is ubiquitous in biology. It's the basis of most, all oxidation and reduction reactions in photosynthesis, vision, smell, and respiration. So most eukaryotic cells have mitochondria. You can see there's an outer mitochondrial membrane and an inner mitochondrial membrane. And in the inner mitochondrial membrane, there's 5 enzymes are embedded. They have complicated chemical names that I can't remember, but they luckily people call them complex 1 to 5. So the first 4 are involved, are part of form the electron transport chain. So the energy from electron transport goes to creating this electrochemical gradient across the mitochondrial membrane that we heard Paul mention in his talk earlier. The protons are then used in this complex 5 of the ATP synthase to generate ATP, which is, I'm sure you know, is the energy currency molecule used for many reactions throughout the cell. So we're focusing on this first enzyme, respiratory complex 1. Now it's a beast. The eukaryotic one has 46 protein subunits, and the prokaryotic one has 14 subunits. Most of the data, experimental data, comes from experiments on this one. But the nice thing is that they have the same set of cofactors, the basic elements within that, you know, contribute to the functioning. So you can kind of think of the prokaryotic one as like the minimal sort of test bed for the larger version. So you have 2 domains. You have a hydrophilic domain and the hydrophobic domain, which is embedded in the inner mitochondrial membrane. So an NADH molecule donates 2 electrons to this flavin mononucleotide, and these sequentially travel down 7 iron sulfur clusters here until they reduce this quinone molecule 1 by 1, and when the 2 electrons are there, mechanical work is done which shifts this portion and allows 4 protons to be translocated across the membrane space by, at the moment, as far as I'm aware, by an unknown mechanism, exactly how this works, but I haven't checked the literature recently. But so we're going to be focusing on this part of the chain. So we have, as I said, 7 iron sulfur clusters. Most of them are 4 iron, 4 sulfur. This site 2 here is a 2 iron, 2 sulfur cluster. The typical distance between them is around 10 angstroms, so it's comparable to the a distance is in the photosynthetic complexes. Each site, each iron sulfur cluster is around one angstrom. You have a largest distance between the sites 4 and 5 compared to the others, 14 angstroms, and we'll see how this has an effect on the sort of transport later on. One experiment has been done actually by these guys here to measure the electron transfer rates in this complex. So the average, what they found is the average time for an electron to be on site 7 was around 90 microseconds here. And with similar parameters, we've calculated using, normally this electron transport is modeled using a diffusive rate equation. So using the semi-classical Marcus-Jordan rates, we've calculated that for a 50% probability of reduction of this quinone, which is we accept to here, it would be 304 microseconds. So there's room for a change in the model to come closer to what the experimental value was. This semi-classical rate equations is not quite making up this difference here. Okay, so our aim is to develop a simple microscopic model of electron transport in respiratory complex 1 and to investigate under realistic parameters where possible whether quantum coherence may exist and whether it helps to speed up the transport in this molecule. Okay, so to facilitate this, we use what is known as from condensed matter physics as the Holstein Hamiltonian. We're going to use a polaron transformation later, as we've just heard about from Asan. And this Hamiltonian has three parts. There's an electronic part, so these are just the bare on-site energies of each of the sites. These are just the usual fermionic creation and annihilation operators. We've got the tunneling amplitudes here. We're going to model each iron sulfur cluster actually as having one vibrational mode, even though we know there's a whole host of them, but just for simplicity to get some qualitative results. So these are our vibrational modes located at each site. And then we have this interaction term here between the electron and the vibrations at each site. So when the electron is present at each site, it shifts the vibrational mode, so you get this displacement, as we just heard from Asan. Okay, so the parameters we're going to use, well, actually in the literature, there's two competing reduction potential profiles, so for the on-site energies. There's a roller coaster one, so where the energies go up and down, and then there's also a flat profile for all the first six sites with a drop, with site 7 being lower in energy by this. And we checked for quantum coherence of the electron for both reduction potential profiles and found that in the roller coaster one, with the rest of the parameters being the same, we found nothing, no coherence, just diffusive transport. So we decided to proceed with focus more on the flat profile. Both have been used in the literature. There's two communities kind of arguing between which one is the correct one, so it's undecided at the moment. So we can say in the roller coaster one, we don't find anything. In the flat one, we see something. So this is how what we're going to use here. The vibronic coupling strength. So this is this G parameter is the coupling between of the electron to the vibrational mode. This is high, so we can use the polaron transformation. And this we get from DFT simulations. You can extract it from the inner sphere reorganization energy. Vibronic frequencies, again, a high frequency in order of terahertz. So these are we take a single frequency and we associate those to the intramolecular frequency of the iron sulfur clusters. And then there's tunneling rates we took from DFT simulations of the electron transport in complex 1. And these are much smaller, the order of gigahertz here. So we can treat the tunneling term as a perturbation in order to get a master equation to model this transport. So the polaron transformation is made explicit using this. So Asan had this in his earlier slides. So when an electron's on a site, we get this shift of the local frequencies. And then we can write down a transformed Hamiltonian where we have the energies are shifted, well, with respect to the reorganization energy. This is just, these are now related to the reduction potential profile that I spoke about previously. And we can see we have this coupling, this tunneling term in the Hamiltonian now. So as the electron hops from site to site, these are just the standard displacement operators from quantum optics. We're displacing the phonon modes as the electron's going. And then these are just the vibrational modes. And what this polaron transformation does is just get rid of the vibronic coupling term in the Hamiltonian. So what we can do, because since this T here is small, we can write an effective Hamiltonian down, which is correct to first order. So this term now contains just the diagonal transitions when the phonon number in the bath no longer changes, so it can still be written in the Hamiltonians as it describes like the closed system dynamics. You can see that the tunneling is further suppressed. The electrons picked up an effective mass. So depending on this is in our work, this is of order one, but then as the temperature increases, we have more phonons in the local mode, so we get coherent tunneling amplitude is suppressed even more here. Okay, and of course it's not a closed system, it's an open system, so we're going to model the full dynamics using a Lindblad master equation. So this is the effective Hamiltonian, and then we have three open system dissipative terms here. So the polaron is moving. The polaron is formed from the vibrations of the iron sulfur clusters, yet it's moving within the background of the protein and the solvent. So we need some additional dephasing on top of that. And this we model here using the usual dephasing term. Also, we need to account, first of all, I should say that this is actually the dephasing rate gamma, and this is what we'll call the zero temperature dephasing, and this is an unknown parameter in our work, so we're going to have to, we will vary over this to see when we will see some quantum, in which regimes we'll see some quantum coherence. We need to model also the reduction of the quinone molecule, so when we lose an electron, finally the electron exits the chain to reduce the quinone at the end of it, and this we model just using a sink. And there's some rate of losing the electron off this final site 7 here. And then also we have the incoherent, the second order processes. We have, this is the incoherent hopping term, and it comes from the second order processes. And it can be shown that these are just the usual Marcus-Jortner rates here. So this is like the diffusive hopping, the incoherent hopping, which comes from a thermal activation from interaction with the phonons. Okay. So first of all, we look at the sensitivity of the transport to the zero temperature dephasing. So the black line in the main graph is at physiological temperatures, and we look at the time it takes to achieve a 50% probability of a quinone reduction, given that the electron is initialized at site 1, so we know this occurs. And what we find is that there's an optimum, we get the fastest transport time, so about 35 microseconds for this 50% probability of reduction of the sink at this low value of the zero temperature dephasing. So this corresponds to the sort of low frequency, if a protein and the solvent were very low frequency modes here. Just a comparison, so this 35 microseconds can be compared to these two semi-classical Marcus-Jortner rates is 10 times higher, so we do get a speed up by having using a quantum model to describe this transport over the semi-classical one. Okay, and this inset here shows how the transport varies with temperature. So for very low temperatures, we see that this is a probability of reducing the sink here and as a function of this zero temperature dephasing. So we see that at low temperatures, we don't see much probability to reduce a sink after 40 microseconds. And this is because if we have a large energy difference between the sixth and seventh site, so we need some thermal activation. It needs to be an incoherent hop to go from site six to site seven. And then as the temperature becomes higher, we see a greater sensitivity to the dephasing. And we can see again for the physiological temperature, this red line, that we really get this peak here for the probability of reducing this sink at this low value that we found this optimal transport rate here. Okay, so we can attribute this to a small amount of quantum coherence between the first two sites on a timescale of order of nanoseconds, which is much smaller than the sort of timescale it takes for the electron to get down the whole of the chain. So this is just the coherent oscillations of the electrons between the first two sites. You can see on longer timescales, the transport's purely diffusive. So the electron quickly equilibrates between the first four sites. And then you can see there's hardly any probability for the electron to occupy the final few sites. And this is because there's a large difference between, spatial difference between the fourth and fifth site there. But once the electron does, once the electron goes over to the fifth site, it quickly reduces the sink. And just as a final comment, at relatively high levels of dephasing, our model reproduces the usual Marcus Jortner dynamics. So this is our model, and this is what you'd get from just a purely like diffusive rate equation. Okay. So just to summarize, so what we've seen is a process which is similar to noise-assisted transport. We need a little bit of dephasing, but not too much. It's not the same because we're in the presence of incoherent hopping. Even a small amount of coherence we've seen can lead to a sort of a 10% increase in the electron transfer rate over the like diffusive rate equations. So if quantum coherence is present in this system, in this complex one, then it will help to ensure that electron transfer does not limit the rate of catalysis. So one of the next question is that do such low rates of low values of dephasing exist? And for the future, we'd like to go beyond this sort of Born-Markov master equation. Okay, thank you for listening.